got all the way down in my belly for that one.
Go on, Missy. See what tea will do for you?
Oh, yes, I've had my tea today.
Yes, let's clink clank over that. Tea, here we go. Tea. Yes. All right. What kind of tea do you have?
I too got the Get Happy tea.
Oh, I got Get Happy. It does work.
Yes, it does. See, don't you feel better?
I do. I feel, you know, it's raining. Well, first of all, let's talk about, what is this?
Hello.
Hi. Welcome
to Harmonize with Nina and Kenya.
Yes.
Where we talk about being Black,
being a woman,
being a mom,
being a wife,
being a performer,
and being a Christian.
Christian.
I'm leaving that one in.
And everything
and
else.
And everything else. Right?
And how none of that can balance, but it can harmonize.
And you know, today is a particularly good day to talk about harmonizing.
Okay, child.
Child, my drum section just left.
Listen.
The one violin left that only has, that's half tuned, is playing.
The strings are breaking.
Child, we're trying to bring in one opera singer.
Okay, listen. Okay, listen. So we got to tell y'all what happened, right?
Okay.
So we read this article.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That MotherOprah.com.
Hello, Mother.
Put online. And it's called The New Midlife Crisis. Mm-hmm. And a woman by the name of Ada Calhoun wrote it. It is, I'm going to link it in the show notes.
Yeah.
It is a very thorough, well-researched, and well-delivered article.
Yes. Yes.
Commiss.
Yeah, you're so awesome.
You're so awesome.
But, you hit it on the nose.
But yeah, this thing messed with me and several of my friends. I posted it and I got a lot of response. Like, oh my God,
yes.
Why?
Yes.
So we.
It's a long read for people who don't read.
It is.
It's not a BuzzFeed, like you said.
No,
it's a full article. It's not a book.
No, but it's like a scholarly article. Like, yes, it's real.
Yes, it's very real.
And what it's talking about is women in midlife crisis, but specifically Generation X women.
Now, what range is Generation X? So clear.
Let us consult the article.
Okay.
Because
I know I'm an Xer.
Right. She gives a very specific range of years. And it's actually bigger than I thought.
Okay.
So let me find it because I have it bookmarked. And she defines Generation X as anyone born between 1965 and 1984. Okay.
Wow. And so, that's me. I'm definitely Generation A. Yeah. I won't tell you when I was born. I just was born then. Okay.
Okay. 1965 to 1984.
Mm-hmm.
You are Generation X.
That's
so
right.
Anything before that is considered the baby boomers.
Mm-hmm.
Anything after that, in other words, our kids are the millennials.
Yes.
Right.
God bless our children.
So God bless the children.
God.
All right. But it's talking about, you know, the particular type of midlife crisis that Generation X women are experiencing. Now, it deals with a couple of things that I was like, yes, the whole time, right? Mm-hmm. So one of them, it says, you know, women have not previously been thought of as having a midlife crisis, first of all. that it is a term that was used to describe a psychological phenomena that was happening with the baby boomer men.
Because it was trying to give them an excuse to do what they want when they wanted to do it. So they gave them a label.
That is Kenya's definition.
That's my definition. You can. I wish you would fight me.
Fight,
I wish
fight,
you would.
Fight. She will come with
the
hands.
And
like
the knife.
Rashida taught us.
Yes, right. Miss Corbin? Are you listening?
Andrea.
The knife? Miss Corbin? Is this a dagger?
Which I see before me. Okay, stop. All right, so it talks about that, how women have not been previously thought of as having a crisis.
Mm-hmm.
That's one thing.
Mm-hmm.
Then it talks about the fact that women, Gen X women in particular, experience the crisis in their 40s, whereas men tend to experience midlife crisis in their 50s.
Mm-hmm.
So by the time they're getting around to having theirs, we're done.
Yes.
So that's
unless you're married to an older guy like I am.
There you go.
We're having it at the same time.
There you go. Oh.
Oh, yes.
Right.
Yes.
Bruh.
That's right.
That explains some things. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that officially makes him a baby boomer.
Oh.
So he, oh my gosh, he is old.
He ain't that old, but he cute though.
I know, he is cute. I imagine, I always joke about the fact that I'm like, when you're old and I have to wheel you around in the nursing home, I'm going to have my new boobs. I'm just kidding, Rashida. This is just a story. I'm going to have my brand new boobs and a tiny little waist and be like, oh, my poor husband. I'm going to wheel him right in the nursing home and then I'm going to leave.
You're a nut.
Bye, honey. Oh, eat your applesauce.
So silly.
He's not that old, but you know.
No, he's not. But then the other thing that it talks about, because we just wanted to pull out a few things that, uh-huh. that we want to dive into, mm-hmm. is the fact that so many women in our generation are experiencing, because that's where we are right now. We're yeah. midlife. And it's affecting our health in a particular way. And yeah. that's the way that it's manifesting for women in the, who are Generation X, that 60% of women in Generation X describe themselves as stressed out. 1 in 5 is on antidepressants. Oh. And, yesterday was World Mental Health Day. So that's part of the reason we wanted to jump into this. You all know we talk about it all the time.
It's good not to be in Central Park. I got caught one time.
Oh no.
In Central Park. World Mental Health Day.
Oh, I'm scared.
Oh my God.
I'm scared.
I'm going to just leave that right there. I was like, what the heck is going on here? And so I was like, oh, it's World Mental Health Day. And, okay.
We'll leave those stories for the premium content.
No. No.
Okay, but go ahead.
Yeah.
So, and so, 1 in 5 is on antidepressants. 60% describe themselves as stressed out. And there were certain areas that she highlighted in the article that were really resonant for us. And one of the areas was like financial stress.
Oh, that she hit me right in. I was like, I can't read this no more. What else you got to say?
Right.
Oh.
But it was really interesting because this is the quote that I really wanted to pull out that's right at the beginning of the article. It says, an awful lot of middle-aged women are furious and overwhelmed. What we don't talk about enough is how the deck is stacked against their feeling any other way.
That, oh my gosh, yeah, that was like...
there it is. So, for instance, just to break down the money, not that y'all don't notice.
Okay.
But yeah. I was just like, we've talked about my mind and how it works and how I see patterns and things like that. I'm visual. So this helped me in a particular way. But thinking of it this way, you know, that like when we were entering the job market in our 20s, 30s, like our for real jobs, not like I have my weekend job at the grocery store, but our real jobs, career jobs.
That we were promised to if we went to school and got
if
our degree.
If you went to college and got your degree and you got your good job, the recession hit.
Right.
Then as we were, the recession was easing up and we're ready. Okay, it's like, okay, now we can buy a home. The housing crisis happened.
No, that was more. They got me. Did they get you? They got me good.
And so with those things happening at the same time, happening back to back, then the last thing is in order to have enough money to retire... I mean, we all know how inflation works and all of that, but it's like we have to have almost triple the amount of money to retire than what our parents had.
Right.
And it's, so that's one of the reasons that they cite as, so many, 60%, more than half of the women of Generation X feeling stressed out. 50%.
That's a lot.
Look, I can't even talk. 56%.
Right. 56, that is a lot.
Generation X women still live paycheck to paycheck.
And I bet you that 50%, most of them African American and brown of some sort.
Well, girl.
So for us, if it's 50% for the generation, that means within that 50, it's like 82%.
Right. You're silly.
For black women.
Oh my God.
Okay.
Well, and because...
Or women of color.
Right. And because they were dealing with, like, so many things in the article.
Yeah.
It didn't go as deep into race as a factor.
Yeah.
So I was, you know, mentally calculating, okay, so if that's true for the average, and, you know, if black people are 12% of the population, like, oh, then, and it usually is more than... or usually more than doubles, a lot of those statistics double for us as black people, it's, that's insane. You know,
and the funny thing is, if you have all of, you know, all of this information, well, let's say that you don't know all this information, but you feel it and you don't know how to explain it.
Yep.
And so you carry then the extra weight of the world, thinking and spending your time thinking there's something you can do better or stronger or blah, blah, blah. You need to push yourself more, or what is something that you could do more, you know, and it may not necessarily, it's nothing really you can do. Right. I mean, I'm sure there's always something you can do, but at least you don't have to fault yourself, because that's an extra,
And
the guilt of, did I do it right? Or did I do any enough of that? You know, that if we could at least take away that element, that might lift that mental barrier and, off of us a little bit.
And so I was, you know, I was like, I've been obsessed with the article since I read it and, you know, posted it and sent it to people. It's like, what did you think about this? Did you see this? And I'm like, oh my gosh, did I need to even go to therapy? Because this just told me everything. The answer is yes.
Yes, go. You need to go.
Right. But
you could drink some happy tea.
Right, some happy tea. But then, you know, I was thinking about, so how, not only how does this affect us more so or differently as black women, but if we're artists, you know, which you already don't have a typical life.
Right.
You know, I won't say normal, because what even is that? But we don't have a typical existence.
Right.
How does that affect you? And so then she kind of got into that. She didn't talk about artists specifically, but she talked about freelancers. And she said, so I have friends, well, this is one of the women she interviewed. I have friends over the years who have told me, just quit your shop, quit your job, be the baker, be the cheesemaker, she says. I have never had that option, especially now we have a child. You want to provide security and safety and health insurance.
Yes, honey.
Those things overrule your own personal preferences. But what if something really bad happens? Or if we lose a job? She shudders. For many women these days, a layoff means joining the gig economy. The majority of freelancers are women, and some people predict that half the workforce will be freelance by 2020. But for those who like going to an office or having decent health insurance, or who thought their hustling days were behind them, it can feel like a demotion. And it can make a full-time position more elusive. A resume gap is still seen as a liability, even though some 30 to 40% of highly qualified women take time off at some point to do what? Have children.
Yes, come on. Come on, you know, still in that fight.
Right, you know. To have children and or, here's the other thing, take care of aging parents.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
You know, that's and she touched on that too. The average age of a family caregiver is 49. You know, so it's like,
Mom, did you take your vitamin today? We got one more year. I don't know if I'm gonna be ready. Mom and Dad, take your vitamins. Go walk.
Take the vitamins. But yeah,
but
I
mean, it's true.
We live in the gig economy. That's what we do.
And I wonder if maybe, you know, I feel all of this. But sometimes I have some days where I don't feel it quite as much, or maybe I'm so immune to it because I'm a black woman who's, you know, tried my hand at the dance world, specifically ballet, for a very long time. You know, I have watched my career. I've watched myself try to move in the way that I'm supposed to move in my career, only to get a door slammed after me so many thousands of times. I've gone to the point, I've gotten to the point where I've been able to hone in on my gift and really, you know, not only just enjoy it, but change it, make it better, better.
Change and adapt.
That is all that I do all day long. Do I get, you know, sometimes, not sometimes, but most times, not anything from the money that it, you know, I believe.
Not what you should be getting.
Not, definitely not.
Yeah.
And definitely not with the opportunities to come at me.
Yeah.
And so I've watched this happen. So that's just the world I live in, is because I lived like that for so long. Mm-hmm. I'm like, well, that's just life. Like, that's, you know.
Right.
But, you know, it's not. Because yeah. now I'm in a position where I see that other 50% that's mm-hmm. not going through it. Mm-hmm. And I'm very aware of, yeah. And in that 50%, many of them, we don't share the same race. Mm-hmm. In that 50%, we don't share the same generation. Mm-hmm. And so for me to watch myself kind of, you know, really work at my craft in the yeah. best way that I can, mm-hmm. and to watch others, mm-hmm. either from the generation before me,
yep.
or outside of that 50%, or outside of that race that we don't, the mm-hmm. race we don't share.
Yep.
To watch them kind of just kind of step in and be able to do all of this stuff. I always then, the first thing I do is question myself. Mm-hmm. Could I have done this enough? Could I have done that enough? Blah, 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 blah. No. This article says, no, this is what you are going through.
Right.
And you didn't do anything wrong.
Right.
This is just what you are going through. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's cool.
Yeah. There is a strange comfort in it.
It's a strange yeah. comfort in it, but at the same time, this is where the art kicks in. Mm-hmm. And it has to kick in on full gear. Mm-hmm. Is that, you know, it's tiring, but then that means I have to create another way, and I have to go in another way. You mm-hmm. know, I just, that is what I feel like I have to do. I can either, you know, I can know this information to be armed and create.
Yeah.
And continue to pedal on mm-hmm. and understand that it's just not going to feel that good. Or, you know, I can, you know, I don't know, roll over and die.
Oh, God. But no, I think that is really valid. I think yeah. that's why, you know, one of the reasons why we fight for, we fight so hard for our creativity mm-hmm. because if you do not have some type of outlet,
right,
you will go cuckoo.
Well, let me pause you right there.
Yeah,
I like what you said about fighting for our creativity, because yeah. I'm gonna be real honest. Unless I have certain strong people around me, like yourself, mm-hmm. I can even tell you that I don't know if I would ever even fight for my creativity, because mm. it's so not understood.
Yeah.
By so many people, I would always feel like I'd want to do it. Mm-hmm. But I'm not sure if I didn't surround myself around the right people, mm-hmm. if I actually would do it.
Yeah.
You know?
So that's why y'all are important to me.
I love you, Nina.
I love you too, kid.
But, you know, and I think, I mean, I know we keep going back to this with no. our episodes, but, you know, going back to self-care mm-hmm. and having that, those women around you, so that I can at least have the ability to be armed with the knowledge and fight mm-hmm. for, mm-hmm. you know. But, you know, sometimes you just get tired of fighting.
No, you do.
And I just want it to be given to me.
At you.
Well, just give it to me.
Right. I mean, because that's also what we were...
That's what we were told.
That's what we were told.
You go to college, you get a degree, you're just going to be given a job.
Right.
I did that.
It was romanticized,
yeah.
even, that this is the way it's going to work for you.
Right.
And it's not the way it worked for us. Mm-mm. And it's not the way it's working for our kids at all.
Right, right. Oh, and when that housing crisis hit, because mm-hmm. I had my children later because of my dance career.
Right.
So, and because I was not socially and emotionally ready to have children. 30 was really the new 20 for me.
Uh-huh.
So, uh-huh. I had my children later. So all of that stuff that happened.
Yep.
Happened when I was having my children, and my body is starting to, what's the premenopausal thing that's going on?
Well,
we ain't got to that part.
We haven't gotten there yet.
Okay. So I was doing all that. So for me, everything hit. Mm-hmm. Everything hit. And there's yeah. no way around it but the art of pulling myself out of it.
Right. And so one of the another point that, you know, thinking about the career and all of that, that mm-hmm. the article brings out really beautifully, mm-hmm. she talks about the fact that, you know, thinking along that same line, you go to good school, you get good grade to school, you get to a good college, mm-hmm. you graduate with your degree, you get a good job, mm-hmm. and you work the job for so long, and then you should be able to get a promotion. You should right. be able to move up in the right. rank. You should be able to get seniority and all that kind of stuff.
Even in the acting
Yeah, anywhere.
World
anywhere.
The, right.
And so one of the things that the article talked about is that there is a salary cap that kind of happens for women between 35 and 45.
That's right.
And that, like, whatever you're kind of making then, not hard and fast, but in many cases, is that's kind of where you stop.
Yep.
Whereas for men, it continues to go up the older they get.
Mm-hmm.
And then said, you know, for
Jim. Except for mine, because he's a blue collar man. You know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then it also was saying that, you know, we're stuck between this ceiling of men who continually get higher and higher salaries mm-hmm. and millennials who are able to career jump. You yeah. know, mm-hmm. And jump the ranks. And when I thought about that, I was like, oh my God, that's what was happening
yeah.
to me. Because, you know, I started out in my position, the former position I had, and, you know, here I am, and it's like, and I've worked and I've been with this company for so long, and I have my master's, which is what everybody said, you get the master's, you know, and I was the only one in my immediate family mm-hmm. in my immediate household mm-hmm. to get a master's, you know, and you know, you do all the right things. And then I found myself on a team where everyone else was a man and everyone else was under 30.
Yep.
And none of them had a master's and yep. we're not thinking about getting one anytime soon. And, but we're commanding, salaries that were, if not exactly the same, very, very similar. Mm-hmm. And it's like, how you get to do this at 25?
Right.
And
right,
I'm 41.
Right. Right.
Excuse me?
Yeah, right, right, right.
Excuse me?
Well, I had the same exact experience.
Yeah.
Where,
and yeah. On the one hand, kudos to them.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're fierce.
Like you said, you know? I mean, we, you know, the
but
generation.
But on the other hand, damn, Gina.
You know? Damn, Gina. You know, because, you know, it's great. You want to be able to help.
Right.
You know, many of the people who have access, easy mm-hmm. access to a position that I've done mm-hmm. and still never really got.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there were students of mine. Mm. And so I'm glad.
Speak on
that,
it.
Yes.
Speak on it. People we trained and taught.
Yes. Many of them are students. And many of them, you know, not all, but many of them have all but not acknowledged the fact that mm-hmm. I've, you know, and it's not for them to acknowledge because they're. You know, anyways, that's where I'm going with. So a lot of times you have people that you've given them your tips. You've given them, you know, more than tips. You've trained them. Mm-hmm. You've invested in them.
Literally trained the people
literally
who replace you.
Have to replace you. I mean, it's okay for them to, yeah, but replace. It's okay yeah. for them to go and move in the way. And maybe that's just because in the dance world, it's just everything is just slim pickings.
Yeah.
And so that's nobody's fault. In a sense, but at the same time, I have to kind of advocate for myself because if I don't, mm-hmm. no one else will. I know you all know what I'm talking about mm-hmm. out there. You know, I'm learning a lot about advocating mm-hmm. for self and me and mine.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm doing it now with my children in school. My daughter, she's cool at mm-hmm. this point, you know, but you know, the reality of having a beautiful brown haired mm-hmm. or brown skinned curly haired son
mm-hmm.
is that everybody won't see him the way that I see him. Everybody won't, you know, understand him the way that I do. And they'll like him fine enough, but they may not be able to see his true talent. So as that's hitting me really hard, you know, yeah. I find that I have to advocate in a mighty way for him.
Uh-huh.
To the point where I'm just like, I'm just going to have to use this and that type of tactic. You know, right. And I never thought that I would be that parent that has to show up and uh-huh. be, you know, I have to do it. Yeah. Even with the best of them, you know. So, but I'm learning a lot about giving him a voice, because he don't have a voice right now. He's kid, you know. Right. They're not supposed to have a voice, but you know. But I'm learning a lot about myself, and as fiercely as I will fight for him, mm-hmm. or my daughter or my husband, mm-hmm. you know, I have to fight for myself. And so when I read this article, you know, it just, yeah. it was a lot of stuff that hit me. First of all, I didn't even, when I saw the article, I saw the word crisis and I was like, I don't want to read this because I don't need no more problems.
Right, right.
I got a 99 problem and a crisis ain't no more. I don't want no more. But I only did it because Nina told me to do it. So I read it.
Right.
You know, right. Look, I didn't read all of it though. I'm gonna read all of it. I'm really excited. Well, yeah.
You know.
I want to read all of it. Yeah. But you know, I just think that it helped to validify
those feelings
because I didn't know how to put it into words. I could put it into movement.
Uh-huh. Yeah, there we go. Oh, we're gonna take a boomerang picture of what we term the midlife crisis movement.
It's a step,
right? It's a whole step. We're gonna take a picture of it and put it on Instagram.
I gotta put my lipstick on first, y'all, though.
Absolutely. Yes. So here's this other quote I want to read to you.
Okay.
One of the psychologists she interviewed, Dr. Deborah, it might be Deborah,
okay,
because of the way she spells it.
Yeah.
Lupnitz says, the message Gen X women got was, you can have it all. And that came with better blueprints and also better expectations. Mm. In midlife, what I see in my Gen X patients is total exhaustion. Mm-hmm. That's what brings them to treatment. They feel guilty for complaining.
Yep.
Because it's wonderful to have had choices that our mothers didn't have.
Yeah.
But choices don't make life easier. Possibility creates pressure.
Yes, it does.
I was like, that's a word.
Won't he do it? No,
didn't it just? Okay, that's a word right there. Possibility,
you know what?
Creates.
I'm shutting it pressure. Down. When I go, I ain't cleaning up nothing.
Right.
Not
right, but then here we go, right? Okay. So the possibilities create pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was another part that I was like, see, this is me. This is the point where I went to therapy. And I was like, mm-hmm. I got to get clarity about what's happening in my life.
Right,
what,
right.
What? And so this, here's the quote. Mm-hmm. Meditation, Pilates, mm-hmm. hiking. A ton of research demonstrably proves that how beneficial exercising regularly, quieting your mind, and spending time in nature can be.
They sell you that in the magazine.
Uh huh. No, that's what she says next.
Oh,
obviously,
yeah,
okay. Oprah.com is a big proponent of figuring out what you want in life and mm-hmm, finding mm-hmm. The tools that mm-hmm, will help you mm-hmm, get there.
Right.
Taken to an extreme, though, even the most strategic and useful self-help can mm-hmm. wind up feeling as oppressive as the problems it was meant to soothe.
Say that.
Okay, and that's the thing. Like, we had gotten to the point, you know, with all props given to my former supervisor,
yeah.
you know, where there had been many necessary concessions that were made, you know, she's like, Nina, you have 5 kids. The reality of having 5 kids is that sometimes you need to come in a little later because you got to bring people to school or bring right. people to the pediatrician or meet with the teacher or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. So
at least she understood, my goodness.
Well, because she has kids herself.
Okay.
So, you know, so
I want you all to know, I didn't get all that.
No, you know, so there were things like, she's like, listen, if you know that those are the things that had just on your schedule that day, say I'm coming in, I will be arriving at such and such time mm-hmm. and you can tag those hours on somewhere else. So you mm-hmm. can, you know, if you need to work from home because the kid has it, you know, whatever, we will figure out a way to make all of this.
That's
work.
Amazing.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you know, that mm-hmm. happened. So I basically was handed control of my schedule.
Mm-hmm.
So I was able to do that. Mm-hmm. And then it was like, okay, I have a standing appointment every whatever day it was. I was seeing Rashida at that time because the schedule has changed 5 times.
Right, 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 of course.
So whatever day it was like, Nina has a standing offsite appointment.
She's not the happiest person if you don't show up for that.
No, she's not.
No.
So, you know, the good thing is, good you know, thing. Her gym is like 10 minutes from where the school was.
Right.
It was very easy for me to get there to work out. But so if it was like I think it was like Tuesday at 2:30 or something like that. So Tuesdays, I left the school building at 2:00 and everybody was like, okay, Miss D leaves at 2 on Tuesday. That's what happened.
Okay.
So I had that flexibility. Then I had, you know, just when I say she went above and beyond and made every concession she could possibly make, to make it less stressful. I was like, I need help. She's like, hire an assistant. We'll take it from this part of the budget. Really? Word?
Okay.
Cool. Do it. I went and found, you know, we have a high school here, St. Martin de Porres High School, that the entire school, as opposed to paying tuition for school, because it's a Catholic school, as opposed to paying tuition, what happens is there are many businesses and nonprofits who partner with the school.
That's right.
And the kids go to school 4 days a week, and they rotate being out of the building 1 day a week on an internship, so they're learning real-time job skills. So I had two interns from there, and I had an assistant, and I had my schedule concessions, and I had my workout scheduled, and I had my therapy scheduled. So I'm doing all of these things so that I can be okay to go to work. And there was a point where it just was not enough, okay?
Yeah.
And so then, you know, she says to me, well, do you think you can take yoga? I was like, girl.
Wait, you can take what?
Some yoga. I was like, girl, I cannot add another thing to this schedule.
Do you think we can add an extra day to the week?
You know, it's like, you know, and she was trying to help.
Yeah.
But I was like, there is not space.
Right.
There is not, because here's the reality. There are very few places you can walk to in Cleveland.
Mm-hmm.
And just about everything I have to get to is 20 to 35
That's
minutes
right.
away. So even
and
if
the
I
traffic
have,
is getting worse.
Well, and here's the thing. If I have, so let's say I have an hour long appointment, it's never an hour long. It's 2 hours.
Right.
Because I have to build in the half an hour there and the half an hour back.
That's right.
Right. And so at this point, because I'm managing the schedules of seven people, not by myself, but I'm managing the schedules of seven people, time is one of my most precious and valuable commodities.
Mm-hmm.
I was already getting up twice a week at 4:45 a.m. to be to Rashida by 5:30. Because I had to get up and I needed like 15 minutes to get my life together so I could get in the car by 5 to be to her by 5:30.
Mm-hmm.
So I could be back home by 7 when I needed to start getting them out the door. You see what I'm saying? It's like, this is supposed to help me not be stressed.
Right, right.
like exercise is supposed to help me not be stressed.
Right.
That's what this is supposed to be
doing. Well, I just went through this last week, remember? You had to talk me off the ledge because I was like, I feel like such a scumbag. I didn't go to Bikram today because I had to do this financial thing. You were like, no, you're not a scumbag. You made a good choice. I was like, I did? Yes, that's all I needed. But you know, it's funny, going back to your story, you said she was just trying to help.
Uh-huh.
And I wanted to pause right there because...
Pause.
Okay, so there's this thing that they say in Spanish or in the Latin community.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Antolino told me, hey, boo. And it's in Spanish, but I ain't saying it in Spanish because I have to be like, what this? Okay. But one saint can't clothe another. Okay.
Uh-huh.
And when you said she was trying to help, it's often what happens with our women of the same generation in trying to help. Many times they just are just stressing you out more.
Right.
You know, because we're all going through it and they're going through it so much that, you know.
They're like, girl, have you tried this? Did you read this book?
I'm like,
did you drink this tea?
Stop. Of course, I've done all of that. I've done all of that stuff.
Right.
You know, stop it.
Everybody be quiet. Go to bed.
Yes, everybody. Which is, I love that when you say that.
Right.
What's going on, Nina? I just need to go to bed. All right, then go to bed then.
Right.
Okay. But yeah, I think we're going through it so much all at the same time.
Right.
That our advice is, well, have you tried dot, dot, dot? And then I don't know about your ears, but my ears shut down on have you tried? Because I'm like, oh my God. I can't even talk. My toe is talking right now because my lips are so tired of moving. The only thing I can move now is my big toe, not even my pinky toe.
Right.
You know, so, and I feel that when I, out in my social places where I look to find some type of peace, I get that a lot in those types of places. You know, so it's really hard thing to deal with. But what I'm glad about the article is, again, it very specifically points out what you are probably feeling.
Yeah.
And brings to light those things that you're at least feeling. And, you know, where I felt the weight lift off of me was just knowing that it's not my fault. You know? Yeah. And there's somebody out there, it may not be within this immediate circle, and it may not feel like it all the time, but there is somebody out there who is a doctor who has studied this, who understands and gets me.
Listen,
that's all I need.
Right. No, well, I mean, that's important. You know, finding community, finding fellowship, knowing that you are not the only one has always, for people in general, been important, but for women in particular, you know, finding your tribe, finding your sister in is like, you have to do that. And then this part had me cackling. Okay. So frequently, this is from the article.
Okay.
Women find quieter ways to act out.
Oh, yes. This is fun. I love this one too. Go ahead.
Fitting breakdowns around school drop-offs and business meetings. Mm-hmm. Middle-aged women are smoking in their bedrooms out the window the way they did when they were 16. Says Elizabeth Earnshaw, marriage and family therapist in Philadelphia. They're flirting with old boyfriends via email or compulsively shopping online. They're driving too fast, they're drinking too much, or they're popping Xanax. And it made me cackle because, you know, Kenya and I and all our friends.
Whatever. All of our friends. Zeta, you too, Zeta.
Right. We're all on Glide or Marco Polo. Yes. And so there were messages like this. It would be like, hey, girl. I'm in the parking lot. Tell me to go inside and go to work. I'm trying to sip this coffee before I get it. Girl, I'm now, so mind mad.
Mind you, we have phones. We could just call each other. Right. But it's the fun of it. So she's right. Okay. So yeah.
You know, so we're doing that, you know, and I would tell people all the time, be like, Nino, how can you stand those? You know, I had this Bluetooth headphone, you know, that just kind of sits on your neck. Like, how can you stand it? It's like, no, I need it because I need to listen to my podcast and cry in between the job and picking up the kids from school. It's important time. You know, and I either need to listen to the podcast and cackle full belly laughter or cry or whatever the heck it is I need to do so I can get my mind right before I have to see the kids. And you know, it's really real.
Right.
It's really real.
I just need a Glide. Like, I'm okay. I need the Glide. Yes, yeah. I don't. I wish I knew how to smoke. It's so bad. I don't. Because often
We don't want you to smoke.
I know, but even if I did, then I'd have bronchitis, which would put me in the hospital. And I'm like, I don't know if healthcare would cover that. So, you know, so I can't. So that's out. And Xanax, you know, whatever. When I hurt my leg one time, they gave me the, what is it?
Percocet.
I was excited because I was like, wow, I get to try this drug out. And I tried and I was like, nope, nothing. So then, wait, what else did they have there that you could do? I don't know. But Glide is the one that works for me. That's the one that works. Just being able to connect and get it out. But I think also, I think as artists, we're kind of lucky in a way.
Yep.
Because we always have the world against us.
Right.
From the time that you've decided that you're an artist, you always know you have to advocate for yourself and defend yourself and recreate stuff. You know, when I graduated from college and I was supposedly, you know, I was supposed to get this really cool job. You know, I applied for this really cool job at the same place that I had left, that same place. I applied there.
Yep.
And I had the credentials to do it. Uh-huh. You know, I had as much as any of the people now.
Right.
And I still didn't get that job. I actually was, you know, I was actually in as an open sub. Isn't that something? So I still got cheated with my pay. So, but I was still expected to do everything else that a teacher was doing. So when I figured out that that wasn't working out for me, it was my career that helped me kind of escape that for the next 10 years because I got this panic feeling that I needed to be in New York and, you know, nobody had, you know, was able to train me in Cleveland anymore, and I just needed to go. My heart told me I needed to go, and I did one of those, I'm going to go to New York with $500 in my pocket. And so I did, and I'm glad that I did, but I did. I had a great experience there. I studied at different schools there, worked with different local companies and theatrical companies, and got a chance to do some sports modeling too, met the man of my dreams, you know, all of that, married, whatever, babies, all of that was really great. So I was able to escape a lot of that life because my road was so off the path. The road I had on my path was off the path. So, you know, and I felt good. I was in good health, considering being a New Yorker.
Okay,
considering
I see what you did there.
Right. So
I see what you did there. She led us into our last kind of thing we wanted to dive into.
That's right. So we're, you know, so out of all of that, I was fine. And then, you know, came the baby, and then came the move. And then I had to be back into the reality because I wanted to, you know, I was getting my experience, my New York experience, because at the time with dance, there were no, I mean, you could have gotten a master's degree, but there was not really a master's degree. It was not really a, you know, you got your real experience by either being in the industry, some type of way. You had to be New York, LA, or maybe Chicago or Dallas or something like that. But, you know, you had to be there. Those were the two places that you had to be. And in order for anyone to take you that kind of serious, you know, take you seriously, that's what you had to do. Well, I don't know what happened, but everybody waited until I was good and pregnant with baby number two to say, oh, we have programs so that you can spend all of your time and money to get this dance program now that we're just kicking off. What? What? Now you can't do anything. I was like, why y'all waiting till I have children? You know, I can't, you know, some women can. Some women are really good. They were like, oh, I get my master's degree. I can do all things. You go ahead. That's not the kid. I don't think I could, you know, maybe I could.
Not the kid.
Not the kid. I can't because I'm too scattered right now. Like, I'm already feeling so much pressure.
Let's
I already
breathe.
Know.
Let's breathe. Okay. Come on. That's what it is.
Well, at least that's what I feel right now.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, and I'm not going to fight. I'm like, listen, you know, so I guess I have to go back to my art roots and kind of, you know, recreate or, you know, deal with it in some kind of way and understand that life don't stops and, you know, all of that. I have all of that to fall back on, but it doesn't feel pretty.
Well, and so part of the result of that, this is another thing that the article touches on for Gen X women is the way that it is affecting our health. Yeah. And it's major. And it's a thing that people don't look at often, but you know, our mothers and grandmothers started perimenopause in their 50s and 60s. So perimenopause is the period before menopause. Generation X is starting perimenopause in their 40s.
Hello, Kitty.
And one of the things that, so she interviewed this one doctor, right? And he said that, you know, the average, like she said, excuse me, the average length of time. Well, let me just read the thing.
Okay.
Let me read the thing. Here we go. Okay. Here's the quote from the article. Let me put on my.
Did you have your tea? Did you have a sip?
I did. Okay, my voiceover voice. Here we go.
Yes.
Women will say, why do I feel like crying? Or why do I feel like screaming if I'm still having my periods? Says Joanne Pinkerton. But if your levels of both estrogen and progesterone have fluctuated, look, I can't even talk.
Okay.
Fluctuated.
I hear what you're saying.
In any given cycle, you might have too much or too little of either or of both of them.
Yes.
And perimenopausal women have been found to have an increased susceptibility to depression compared to younger women. Okay. So the other symptoms are no less crummy. Trouble sleeping.
Oh, that's me.
That's starting to gather.
Well, I do need a new mattress, though.
Well, there you go.
Okay.
That's starting to gather around the midsection.
Wait, what did it say gathering around the mid?
Fat.
Oh, my God, the FUPA.
And what is the FUPA, Kenya?
I can't say it on the air.
Oh, okay. Y'all know what it is. Ask your gay friends. They know what it is.
Oh, my goodness.
But go ahead.
No, what is the FUPA? You can
fat
say.
Fat upper pussy area.
The fat upper punani area. All right.
There we go.
There we go.
Thank you, Jeffrey, for telling me.
Okay. And then to continue the quote, she says some 10 to 30% of 40 to 55 year old women she sees are describing having some sort of sexual function problems.
Oh, no.
In other words, the perimenopausal body is the Thunderdome.
Oh, Lord.
And then, so the woman who's writing the article. Miss Calhoun says, you know, so Dr. Pinkerton continues and says, you know, we tell people who are grieving not to make any major changes for a year. Mm-hmm. I don't think anyone has ever said, don't make a major decision when you're perimenopausal. Good idea, I think, says Miss Calhoun. We can just take it easy until perimenopause ends. How long is that anyway? I asked Dr. Pinkerton. I thought she'd say a year, maybe two. Huh? Anywhere from a few months to 10 to 13 years. So picture. Our mothers and grandmothers didn't start that until they were in their 50s and 60s. We're starting that a whole decade earlier than they were. It also says that the study from the Women's Health across the nation confirms that the average white woman's experience of perimenopause is 7 years. For Asian women, it's about 5. For Hispanic or Latino women, it's about 9. And for African American women, it's about 10. You experience perimenopause on average for 10 years. 10 years before it actually starts. So think about it. If we are having this like midlife crisis thing happening in the 40s, and then perimenopause is starting like a whole decade earlier for our generation, and then you have this stress about money and you have the stress about career and you have all of this crap happening at the same time, and then all the messaging is saying, balance your life.
Right?
Deep thoughts.
Deep thoughts with Jack Handy. Right? You know, all this stuff is telling you to balance that. You know, you're doing yourself all this self-harm thinking that you're not good enough, you know, and all this stuff. And
when you should be doing self-harmony.
That's right.
That's right.
Harmonize. Right. They didn't kid you.
That's right. As she sounds like Little Richard.
So all of that to say, friends, that you are not alone.
You're not alone. And you will come out of this.
Yes, because
that's what I needed to know.
When does
it end? Okay. It does end. It's kind of like jail, right? But it ends, right?
Well, that was the like one kind of like hopeful uptick in the article. That there is a study that has, you know, what's the word, identified what they call the U-bend. Yeah. And so this is what the U-bend is. the U-curve is that, you know, people everywhere, not just in the United States, experience some sort of midlife event.
Christ.
Even if not a crisis. Okay. You know, some sort of midlife something that happens. Yeah. They say it even happens in the animal kingdom.
Yeah, that's cool. That's
that was kind of cool.
That is cool. So I think about lions, you know?
Uh-huh.
They definitely have some stuff to go through. I'm sure the woman lion has to go through a lot because she's the one who's been doing all the stuff anyway while he's up on the hill roaring and stuff. No disrespect, Simba. Yeah, I'm just saying.
Oh my gosh. But it's a social science term, the U curve, just referencing a dip in happiness that occurs in midlife. And the research suggests that women's happiness bottoms out around the 40s, men around the 50s, and then
that's what I was saying. Me and Joseph are going through
right. But then it you know starts to swing back the other way.
Okay.
And so then, you know, of course, because we are generation doing too much.
Yeah.
You know, she asked the question, you know, are we a generation that doesn't have a U-curve? What if it doesn't turn back around for us? And I'm like, girl, don't take away the hope after you gave it.
Yeah, I know. Look, bitch, don't be starting that shit. We about to create some U-turn up in this bitch right now. That's the artist in me.
You made Kenya cuss.
I know, that's right. You're not taking us down that damn rabbit hole. Hell no, I have to come up out of there.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Yeah, I'm like, stop that.
Yeah,
No, we going to have our U-curve.
We having a U-curve, damn it.
That's where the faith part comes
in. That's right.
We coming out of this mess.
Look, it's true. We don't have the same crisis in the same way that our mothers have. But, you know, when I always think of this, and I know that it's comparing, but still, because I have the pictures that hang on my wall
Yep.
of my my great grandmother, mm-hmm. and I have those pictures of the women. I actually have them. I was lucky enough to have those pictures.
Right, right.
And I look into their eyes and I see myself and I'm like, it feels bad. I feel like I should be further, mm-hmm. but I'm not going to complain because, you know, for me to even be here
right.
is a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not going to, I didn't experience the Middle Passage. I'm right. sure they had a midlife crisis too.
Okay.
I experienced the second Middle Passage okay. where you had to go from the south to the north.
Right.
So that's like the first thing I think about. That's probably why I don't allow, or I try not to allow, or no, better, I suppress a lot of the midlife crisis, mm-hmm. which is not good either.
Right.
But I also know that every generation comes up out of it. And I will even say, and this is not to... you know, put any bad hex or anything on the future generation. I certainly don't want that. But I think in every generation, you're going to be hit with some type of curveball
mm-hmm.
that you're not prepared for, that we probably created.
Mm-hmm.
So I apologize in advance for that. But you're going to be hit with it, and it seems fine now, but it's coming. And so right. you want to be... really open to understanding your foundation.
Right.
Because it's going to happen.
Right.
You know, there's no escaping out of it. And yeah, but yeah. you too will come. I'm sure you'll find a way to come out, out of it.
They have to.
Yeah,
because,
right.
Because that's how we survive. That's
yeah.
That's how we go forward. That's how we go on.
Right.
And, you know, basically our whole message today is you are not alone.
Yes, you are not. You are not alone. Mm. Mm. I am here with you. Mm. Mm. I wish I knew the rest of the song, because at this point I start counting to the music and coming right. up with choreography.
Right.
Steps you take. Okay, all right.
Okay. So funny. But yeah, you know, it just really resonated with me. It
yeah.
was, as much as it was jarring, it was also... comforting to kind of say,
it
oh,
is.
Okay. So I maybe because, this is yeah. just a part of the process.
Yeah.
It
allows me not to say to myself, oh, I hope my mom is not so disappointed. She's so disappointed in me.
Girl,
or
she's
to say, I know. But you know,
yeah.
because she's of that generation where it's like, well, we started off with no money. And
right.
I mean, no money. Like my parents were so broke when they got married. He had to move back home, and she had to move back. He lived in Alabama, and she lived in Tennessee.
Lord
they
goodness.
Had no home together. But, you know, because they didn't have anything, they were able yeah. to build and continue to build.
Right.
But for my generation, we had stuff to build on, but we were given debt. For example, mm-hmm. and I think I understood this when I read The Millionaire Next Door.
Mm-hmm.
You have, you know, as a baby boomer, who gives birth to a Generation X person who is now married, they may purchase a house.
Mm-hmm.
The house they purchased, of course, was through predatory lending, and they're about to lose it. But nobody knows that at that point.
Right.
And so as a gift, you give them cable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you start them off for 3 months of cable, and then they're responsible for paying everything else. But what did you do? You gave them
right.
cable. But now you just gave them an extra debt
yeah.
to continue to pay for, because everybody has cable. So that becomes, you know, oh my gosh, we're getting the cable shut off. We're a complete loser, because Generation Baby Boomer bought this for us. And Generation X is responsible for, you know, they didn't even have that. So we've got to carry it on. Basically, all you're doing is just throwing your money away.
Yeah.
And then who feels bad about it when you can't pay the cable, you can't pay the insurance, you can't pay this, you can't pay that, and your house is being taken away from you? You know, you bear a lot of the guilt and the shame that happens with that. And, you know, again, when you say that it's hit, this crisis hits, and, you know, by the way, did I go through all of that?
You did.
Yes, I did. Right when I was pregnant. The second time around, yes, I did. So for a good chunk of those years,
yeah.
I was so in it, you know.
Yeah, well, all of us were.
Well, all of us were.
It was,
right.
It was the entire, I mean, because the housing, particularly in Ohio, the housing
yeah.
market crashed.
Mm-hmm.
And it really was a crash.
Yeah.
Affected so many of us.
Yeah.
that, you know, people who had never lived in poverty found themselves in poverty.
Oh, yes. I can relate to good times.
Right.
Before, right. I was a Huxtable person.
Well, I was.
And now. Okay. Now I can relate to good times.
Right.
Keeping your head up above. That's hilarious.
I mean, we have been through that because of my mother's illness and death.
Yeah,
so,
right,
you know, I have said it before. I will say it again. I am well acquainted with the taste of government cheese and peanut butter.
Oh, yes, honey. You can make some lovely cheese sandwiches. We didn't have that, and we still had to, because we had the strike.
Well, there's that, too. Mm. But the thing is, you know, we get told, and when we look at it and step out of it,
mm-hmm.
The fact of the matter is, we have done more mm-hmm. than our parents
yeah.
and our grandparents were able to do. You know, my grandmother, Mama, was a sharecropper. She had a third grade education. You know, my grandfather was a veteran. He and his brothers and her brothers bricked that house in one day. Oh, that was one of my favorite stories that used to tell, you know, and they had the seven kids in that one house, and all of her kids who wanted to go went to college. But had a third grade education. I think Papa probably had only, I will have to check with my aunties, but a third to fifth grade education, because they had to work,
right,
you know, because they were like the oldest in their families and stuff like that. You know, and I went farther than my father and my mother did. You know, well, no, my mother had a master's, but my dad didn't, you know. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I got to go farther than he went, you know, because he was the living parent that I grew up with.
Right,
You know, so in terms of that, yes. And I know where Jonathan and I are currently, even though it feels tight.
Yeah.
We've been tighter.
Oh, yes. Same here. Yeah.
We have been way tighter.
Yeah.
And I
understand.
Right. And I don't know that my father ever achieved the financial stability where we currently are right now.
Right.
So in terms of, you know, going a step farther, we absolutely have.
You've actually done that. I don't know if we've done that in
our
family. We've gone a step.
Well, you still got time, girl.
Yeah. But you know what? That's why I'm not too. That actually gives me comfort.
Right.
That actually provides me comfort. And what else provides me comfort is I'm a different person.
Mm-hmm.
My family is a different family.
Yep.
And we just work in a different way. For me to think that my family will work out the way that my family worked that raised me, I will be boo-boo the fool.
Right.
To compare myself to that or to try and achieve it in that way.
Right.
And I think what I'm supposed to learn from this lesson of going through all of this is that I don't need to go in that way. I have to go into another way.
Absolutely. And the thing is, it's like we say this all the time about our work as artists. You have to define what success is.
Right.
If I didn't have the master's or any of the other career kind of achievements that I have, in another sense, I would still say I've gone farther than my parents.
Right.
You know, because my household is truly peaceful and happy.
Yes.
You know, which in my childhood was not the case.
Right, 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 right.
Okay. You know, there were moments, you know, I would be lying if I said there weren't moments and bright spots.
Mm-hmm.
But by and large, my childhood was not happy.
Right.
But my kid's childhood is.
Right.
That's
a big deal.
And that is a huge deal.
Right.
And I count that more a success than anything else.
You are. Well, in that case, we rock.
Right.
Mine was happy, but, you know, my husband brought to our relationship some of what he'd experienced, and it was rough.
Mm-hmm.
It was very rough. And he didn't have his father or, you know, to grow up or, you know. But he always made the best of what he had, and he brings that to the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean that we haven't had our moments.
Mm-hmm.
But with my background coupled with his background, we oscillate a lot of times, but for the most part, They're joyous kids.
Yeah,
they're very joyous.
They are. Gosh, oh my gosh,
yeah, a little too joyous in Spanish class. He needs to be not so joyful, talking, telling jokes and asking questions off topic. But for the most part, you know, when people talk about my children, they're always. Yes. It feels good because it's an extension of what they feel from home, which I like them. They're, you know, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, Jordan's a little loud, but, you know, so was I, you know, right. But, you know, at least that is a success, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's what you do want to achieve because you don't find that in too many Black families is achieving that happiness. You know, we chase the papers all the time. Mm-hmm. We're chasing careers all the time. Mm-hmm.
I think that's not true either. I think that is what we're told.
I agree. Yeah.
That's what we're told. You're right. you attract to yourself what you are.
Yeah.
Or what you desire to be.
Right.
And, you know, we actively seek out fellowship.
Yeah.
You know, with people.
Yeah.
Who are doing what we're doing.
Right.
And that is doing the work.
Yeah.
To absolutely pursue our own happiness.
Right.
Life.
Yes.
Liberty.
Liberty. Yes, right. We have the right.
Damn it. Dang on it.
I hope that you all have learned a little something.
Yeah, we were loud today.
I was right up
on the mic.
Yes. You know what? I didn't expect that I was going to get so loud. It's a rainy day in Cleveland. I had a rough morning.
We done sang Negro Spirit about seven times.
I know, right? I'm telling you. But first of all, the happy tea does help.
Don't it though?
It really do.
I'm going to put a picture of the happy tea on it. Y'all, this tea, I found this tea at, what's that store?
Whole Foods.
There you go. Whole Foods. Yeah, you're right. No, Whole Foods.
I was about to say Whole Foodulous.
No. But that is the name of it. It's called Get Happy.
Yes.
And it has African Red Bush tea. It's a blend of African Red Bush, St. John's wort, and something else.
Oh, that's the St. John's
wort. The rooibos tea.
Yes, okay, there you go.
But I've had just straight St. John's wort before, and it don't do nothing for me. But this particular blend,
yes,
it feels like really... I took a Xanax.
Oh, wow.
I've never had a Xanax.
Okay.
But the way people describe how the Xanax helps them, that's how I feel when I drink this tea.
So I would rather funny pay. Because you would think we were just some beer smoking kind of girl. I couldn't wait to take my little pill. Yeah, did you take it?
Yeah, I didn't get anything out of it.
Right?
I wish I could smoke weed.
Do you smoke?
No, I really can't do that. It'll set off my bronchitis.
But we are so plain.
But you know, I mean,
it's okay.
I don't mind.
Yeah, it's okay.
And again, because you know,
we glide.
Okay. If you are blessed by Xanax, continue to be blessed.
Yeah, go
okay.
Because
listen, I'm gonna tell you this. Is something I tell people all the
time. Therapy would be nice, though. You know?
No, I'm gonna tell you what I tell people all the time.
Okay.
Because you can't get Xanax without therapy. You have to do it hand in hand. No, I'm saying they won't prescribe it unless you're also doing therapy.
You can't just get Xanax. Okay.
So
I don't care who you know.
What I was gonna say was, I just tell people all the time. The Bible says. Laughter doeth good like a medicine.
Yes, it doeth.
Now, here's the thing, though. If you break that down, that means medicine is good. So if you need to take your medicine, take it.
Take your medicine, honey.
Because they say it does good like a medicine, which implies that medicine is good.
If A equals B
and B equals C, then A equals C.
Yes, take your medicine. Don't forget.
Take your medicine and laugh.
Yes. Yes, there you go. Take your medicine and just laugh.
Right. All right, we done, because now we
done. Woo. Yeah, we going into a whole nother podular.
I feel high.
Yeah, do it really? I just feel awake. I'm just happy.
No, I mean,
because
from
when
the
I
tea.
Came in here, well, when I came in, I was like, it's a rainy day. I feel like Daria. You remember that cartoon? It's a rainy day.
Girl, I love Daria.
We love Daria. Trish, you remember us watching Daria?
Listen,
I'm going to
tell you what my joke was. Okay, so my sister, World Peace.
Yes.
No, girl, she's Daria. Like,
is
the,
she real?
The dry.
Well, Jin Lei is Daria. Oh yeah, totally. Yeah.
I mean, just the dry wit.
Yeah, yeah.
You know how they all this foolishness would be happening, and it would go on and on and on for like 2 to 5 minutes, and then she'd say one thing, and it'd lay you out. Yeah, yeah. That's
yeah.
Bye, y'all. Bye. We love y'all. Ha ha ha.